In the previous video, we looked at the 60 minutes interview transcripts, which were for the adult audience. We have a look at transcript 2 in your controlled assessment booklet, which is the Blue Peter interview. Blue Peter is a popular children's television program, so obviously the audience here is a lot younger than the 60 minutes. So we're going to see some differences in both the presenters and J.K. Rowling's language to make it more suitable for children. If we look right from the start, it's a lot more positive than what we saw in the 60 Minutes interview. So we have a presenter being very positive and encouraging, good to have you back on Blue Peter. And J.K. Rowling really emphasises it's wonderful to be here. So wonderful is a very positive word, it's sort of word you're going to use around children. She sounds and looks very enthusiastic when she says that, as you will see in the video. So she's making it sort of exciting for the children. Again, when she says, oh, happy birthday, she's not saying it in a sort of just a slightly excited way, like you might say to another adult, but it's very enthusiastic. It's, oh, happy birthday. So she's really sort of over-exaggerating, making it sound very exciting for the children because it's sort of this happy occasion for this kid called Harry. If we look at the sort of questions being asked here overall, the questions are mainly to do with the plot of Harry Potter, you know, what things have happened, why did you decide to kill Dumbledore in the sixth Harry Potter book, will I cry when I read the next book, do your children pester you about what's going to happen in the next Harry Potter book. So they tend to be more about the stories themselves and the sort of content within them, which is of course what children are interested in, the stories. In the adult 60 minute interviews, it was asking about J.K. Rowling's background, her childhood, how she plots the stories. So it's going more into depth and it's more about the person behind the stories than the stories themselves. So the subject matter has changed because it's more for a child audience. Similarly, J.K. Rowling's responses change. They're a lot shorter here. Look, one line, very quick line there. Got a slightly longer one there, but then we're back to single lines, one or two lines, a couple of lines. So these are a lot shorter responses than we got in that very first interview where she's always saying like a full paragraph each time. So she's really going into detail for the adults, but for the children, obviously she goes into a bit less detail. As we said in the previous video, these answers are shorter, but that was more because she perhaps didn't want to talk about this subject in depth. Not because she was keeping it simple for children. So different influences there. Alright, looking at the language she uses. Why did you decide to kill Dumbledore in the sixth Harry Potter book? Not because I'm horrible. Horrible is a lower register word, particularly for comparative words such as nostalgia and vicious in the first interview. So it's more suitable for children, it's the sort of word a child might use. She tries to sort of soften the blow, so she's killed this character, not because she's horrible, because it's an important part of the story, so she's telling it sort of factually for the children, and being very firm, Andy is dead. Then we have the presenter and J.K. Rowling engaging in a sort of slightly childish game where they're repeating, presenter, is he really dead? He's dead. Is he really dead? He's very dead. Are you sure? Yes, I should know, shouldn't I? So it's almost like a sort of a childish game, this back and forth. So again, more suitable for children. Tracking through the interview, the next question from another child is about will I cry when I read book 7? J.K. Rowling responds with a question to bring the child into the discussion, to make them more involved, asks her that question back, and then J.K. Rowling uses hedge language when she says probably. So I think you'll probably cry at this book, I think, as well as hedge. So rather than saying you will cry at this book, which might sound quite harsh to a child, it's I think you'll probably cry. So sort of softening the blow of that, because obviously the children are maybe disappointed or sort of worried about that, because they don't want to be too upset. Again, in this answer we have lower register when she talks about the word mummy, and if you listen very closely, a sort of more advanced point you can make is about how her tone of voice changes. So she does it in a kind of quite a jolly, kind of funny way, which my 2-year-old definitely doesn't know that I write Harry Potter, doesn't know what Harry Potter is. And my 4-year-old when you say, what does mummy do? He says, Harry Potter. She does a sort of voice here, like imitating the child's voice. So she's making her speech sort of quite exciting for the children who are listening by doing different voices, by putting emphasis on different words. And then as soon as she starts talking about her 4-year-old and talks about her 14-year-old, her tone of voice changes quite significantly. So she becomes a lot more serious here. But my nearly 14-year-old, it's better for her not to know because it's a big weight for her to bear. So she's gone to a very serious tone of voice here to sort of indicate that this is a slightly more serious issue, that it would be maybe difficult if her 14-year-old child knew about what was coming up in the books and was sort of being pestered about it. Moving on, she gives plenty of detail here. Which books do you like writing most? She's very quick because she's maybe thought about his answer already. Perhaps she prepared some of her answers in advance. Certainly we see less ers and ums in this interview than in the previous one. So which books do you like writing most? Clearly she knew straight away 3, 6 and 7. And then she gives extra detail to make sure the children know which ones they are. Azkaban, Half-Blood Prince and Deathly Hallows. We then have this question from Hayley about what projects are coming up, and again in the response J.K. Rowling is using a lot of hedge language because she doesn't want to sound too harsh when she's responding to the children. So she says, I'm not going to promise anything I think at the moment because you really do want to take some time off. I've loved the writing of Harry Potter, but I think it's healthy for me to probably take a bit of a holiday now. She could have said that more bluntly. She could have said, oh, well, I'm exhausted from writing so many books so close together. I need a break because I'm tired. But that might sound disappointing for the children because it sounds like she hasn't enjoyed writing, but it hasn't been a good experience. So she makes it very clear, using positive language, I've loved the writing of Harry Potter. And then she uses hedge language to soften the blow of her saying she's going to take a bit of a break. So rather than saying, as she could do, it's healthy for me to take a holiday now, she adds that hedge language, I think, probably, and a bit. So it softens the blow, makes her more gentle, so she can say what she needs to say without sort of upsetting the children. On to the second part of the Blue Peter video. Again, she sounds very excited when she's talking about the theme park, so she shouldn't say, oh yeah, it'd be cool to open theme park, but when the child says, will you try out all the rides? She's like, oh, I hope so. She sounds really excited. She's making it exciting for the children. Again, a lot of positive language. Brilliant. Amazing. So she's very upbeat, very positive in this interview, in ways which she wasn't in the earlier interviews when she's talking about her childhood and writing on welfare. I think one other key point you can draw out from this interview is this question, where the child asks, if you have a sorting hat, which house would you choose for Gordon Brown and David Cameron? At the time of the interview, Gordon Brown was the Prime Minister of the UK, David Cameron was Leader of the Opposition. So there's laughter, but probably because it's quite a sort of difficult question. You know, how do you answer this kind of political question and make it appropriate for this childlike audience? So JK has to think about it a little bit. She does this filler where she goes, ooh, to let us know she's thinking. And then the answer she gives is that Gordon Brown should go in Gryffindor because it's the red house. Gordon Brown was a member of the Labour Party. Labour's colour is red, so she's just using the colours there. Similarly, David Cameron goes into the house with the blue colour scheme because he's conservative. Blue is associated with conservatives. So she's been quite clever there in making this appropriate for children, because she could have started talking about political theory, about their different positions and their policies and how that would influence which house we would go into. It could be a really in-depth debate, but that wouldn't be appropriate for children. It wouldn't be interesting. They wouldn't really understand too much about politics. They just kind of know who these two figures are, sort of from the news and newspapers. So she makes it very simple and very unpolitically biased, or unbiased politically, so that it's appropriate for children. Final thing she says is about her writer's block and how she gets over it, and again we hear her using different tones of voice to make it funny. So when she does the, oh, this book's terrible, and she puts on a voice and it makes it more humorous and engaging for the children. So you wouldn't, she does do a bit of a voice in the first interview for adults. She does the voice when she talks about, oh yeah, there's a boy who used to wait for me on the corner of our street with a cricket bat, and she makes it quite sort of sarcastic, and she's sort of impersonating other adults, but it's not in such a fun way, it's not like a jolly way like it is for the children, where she does this silly voice, oh, I can't do it, this book's terrible. So again, she's adapting her language, making it more appropriate for the child audience. So we've covered all five clips across these few videos. Hopefully that gives you some ideas for points you can make in your controlled assessment.